Morgan.
I'm Deanna.
And we go to Binghamton University, and we're going to be on the Snapchat today. Ask us your questions.
Hello. So again, my name's Deanna. I'm a sophomore at Binghamton University, and I'm an integrative neuroscience major prePA student.
Hi, I'm Morgan. I'm a premed student, and I'm also an integrative neuroscience major here at Binghamton, and I'm a sophomore. Me and Deanna actually run an Instagram account called Our Med Journey, which highlights the differences between the pre-med track and the pre-PA track, so everyone give it a follow. Deanna is actually taking a test right now for her biological anthropology class, so it's just going to be me for the next hour or so. So send me your questions about pre-med. Me and Deanna are also New York State certified EMT basics, so if you have any questions about that, also ask. We both really love it, and it's really great for pre-health students. I think it's very important to note that this is a very personal journey, and everyone's path to getting to medical school is going to be different. I think that it's really important to use your time wisely and choose to do things that interest you and that you're really passionate about. Because that passion will show through in your interview into medical school, and you know, they want people who are enthusiastic and who really care and are really, really passionate about it. So I would say speak to your passions. So obviously one of them is going to be medicine if you're applying to medical school. So you want something that is related to medicine, whether that be volunteering in a hospital or becoming an EMT or a nurse assistant or a medical. But your entire life doesn't have to be consumed by medicine. You know, do things that you're interested in. It doesn't have to be medicine. It can be joining the art club or. And now what I'm doing personally to get into medical school, I'll list it down below and then I'll go into further detail on each one of them. So stay tuned. So I could go on and on about how amazing being an EMT is for a pre-medical student, but I'll try and keep this short and sweet and to the point. So I think the most obvious benefit of being an EMT is direct patient contact, which is pretty invaluable in this process. I also learn basic life support skills that a lot of med students actually don't even learn until their third year. So even something like taking blood pressure, even something as simple as patient assessment, you know, you really get that experience. You get to cultivate those skills and to learn what your style is, and you gain that sense of comfort that comes from experience. So you kind of already have a leg up when you get to medical school, which is really great, you know, to start out with. It's also really fantastic to find out if you even really want to go into the medical field. You know, you kind of are just thrown into it, into those situations of taking care of patients and being in high stress situations. And you'll know very quickly if you like it or if you don't like it. And, you know, you could save a lot of money by figuring that out sooner rather. Another way that it's really great is that it gets you used to working in teams. So in the back of an ambulance, you work in a team with other paramedics, EMTs, aides. So it's really getting you prepared for modern day healthcare, which is working in teams with doctors, nurses, nurse practitioners, PAs, So now for research, I'm a part of the Health, Human Behavior, and Evolution Research Group here at Binghamton University. And our research is mostly, my research in particular is on immunosuppression in the luteal phase of naturally cycling women. So the way that I got into research was actually just being in the right place at the right time. I took a really awesome class called Darwinian Medicine, and I really fell in love with the class, and I really connected well with my professor. And at the end of the class, I asked her if I could help her with her research, and she said yes. So definitely don't be afraid to reach out. You know, networking is so important in this field. I mean, any field really, but you know, the answer is always no if you don't ask. So always ask. I actually just applied to the undergraduate research grant here at Binghamton, and hopefully that goes through because that could lead to more research for me because I really want to continue my research next semester. Grant writing is such an important skill and also a very marketable skill. A lot of medical schools want to see that you can bring money in and they want to see that you're going to do research. So if you can get a grant and have that on your CV, it's going to look really good for you for medical school. So I would really suggest research if you like it. But don't feel forced to do research if you really don't like it. Don't do something that you don't like because it's going to show through in your interview. And you don't want to do things just to pad your resume. Medical Roots Project is a new club here on campus. And basically they are a public health outreach club, which I'm really passionate about public health. So I'm really excited for it to start up, and I'm also applying for an internship through the Medical Roots Project over the summer. Now, shadowing is pretty important because you want to get a real feel for what being a doctor is actually like in, you know, modern day healthcare. I didn't know this until I started shadowing, but apparently because there's such a need and a shortage of primary care doctors that it really helps you out if you have an interest in primary care and if you shadow a primary care physician who writes you a letter of recommendation. So if you're interested, it's Binghamton actually has a mentorship program with SUNY Upstate Medical School where undergrads get paired up with medical students who are now their mentor. My mentor is amazing. Stephanie, if you're watching this, I love you. She is a fourth year medical student going into psych, and it's a really, really great opportunity to have someone to, you know, bounce questions and concerns off of anytime you need to. I text her anytime I have a question, and it's just nice, especially because she's also a woman in medicine. So if your school doesn't have a program like this and there is a medical school nearby, I would actually really suggest reaching out to that medical school, maybe even starting up this program. That would look really good on your application too.
Hey guys, I'm back for my test. We just got a question asking about how the EMT course is run.
So basically, you don't need any medical knowledge prior to the course. You learn everything that you need to know in the course, and you do have a textbook that you do readings from that your course is.
So the EMT course, it consists of didactics, so your lectures, and then another night of the week you'll do your lab portion where you learn all your hands-on skills.
So our course was Mondays and Wednesdays from 6 to 10, and then two Saturdays a month from 9 a.m. to 5 p.m., and that ran for an entire semester.
So the EMT course was a lot of work, and it was definitely a huge time commitment. It was hard to do during the semester. They do offer it over the summer, though. So we just got another question asking how we study for our science classes. That's a very tough question to answer since there's a lot of different types of science classes. So for biology courses, they tend to be very memory heavy, so you'll want to memorize basically all the information. So what I like to do for biology courses is I'm a big fan of making index cards. I think that when I write them out, that helps me remember it too, and then I get to study them over and over. So I recently switched over to from like the paper index cards to Quizlet. It's the app. I'm in love with it. I'm the queen of Quizlet. I love it so much. So Quizlet has you put in your terms and your definitions, and then at the end you can use the cards and you just study the index cards, or you can, on top of the cards, they also have a matching section so you can practice matching. They also have a test section that you can do true or false questions. So for the test question of Quizlet, you can do true or false, multiple choice, or written questions that you can practice with, and I really recommend it. It helps me a lot.
So for general chemistry, I'd say my biggest tip is practice problems. Do a million of them and keep doing them until you don't get them wrong. I also really recommend going to office hours, so don't be afraid to reach out to your professor because they can be really helpful. Also, if your school has a tutoring service, mine does, and it's really helpful. A tip that I actually got from Andrea Tooley from A Doctor in the House is to use whiteboards to do all your practice problems on and also just write down all the information. That way you're not wasting paper, and also it's a lot easier on a whiteboard than it is on paper to, you know, constantly rewrite things because that repetition will really help it stick in your brain. So for organic chemistry, I actually went to my professor and had a private meeting with her about how to study for the course because I felt like I never really had a plan of attack for the material. I would kind of just go in blindly and try and memorize as many trends and as many reactions as I possibly could, and I wasn't really getting anywhere with that, so I don't really recommend that. And she recommended this way of studying reactions where you look at the reaction and then you write down each step in words and then just keep doing that, and it'll help you to really understand what's happening in the reaction and therefore memorize it better because you actually know what's going on instead of just memorizing random pictures.
Okay, so we just got another question for how are direct patient care hours recorded for EMTs. And basically your agency will most likely have a website that you're going to sign into and clock in at the beginning of each shift, and that website will most likely track your hours, and you can actually go on and look in a link and it says time card for your volunteer hours and however many hours. Most agencies use eSchedule, it's a website, but other agencies may use different things, so it's really an agency-to-agency basis. So what I would recommend is when you first join an agency, talk to the people and say, how do I track my hours when I'm working here? And they can tell you where they track.
So medical school is different than PA school in the sense that you don't have a set amount of hours that you need in order to apply to that school for volunteering or patient contact. Also, volunteer hours and clinical exposure are pretty much two separate categories when it comes to applying to medical school. So volunteering doesn't necessarily have to be medically based, but you do need clinical exposure in some way. So that could be shadowing, that could be as an EMT, and you need that clinical exposure because you need to show medical schools that you know what you're in for and you're in it for the long haul, because they make an investment in you by training you and educating you. So for volunteer hours, there's no set number on how much is enough, but I think consistency is key. So you want to be consistently volunteering. So all throughout your undergrad and pre-medical years, I think it's important to show a dedication to service to your community and do that through volunteering.
Again, it's just important to note that all that information was for medical school only and not for PA school, because PA school does have a specific number of hours that you need. Okay guys, so unfortunately we have to go to our statistics class, but we'll be back on in like an hour or so to answer more questions. So the question we just got was asking for some tips to pass the National Registry EMT exam, and one of the things that Morgan and I are both New York State EMTs, so it's a little bit different for the National Registry exam, but I believe that you can still study with similar techniques. So what I did to study for the EMT exam, throughout the course, I outlined each chapter, which really helped me get a good understanding of. And again, going back to the Quizlet, my favorite, I put in a bunch of terms and also made up some questions for myself, like what would you do in this situation with. So most of the EMT course has a lot to do with memorization. So index cards definitely helped me memorize everything and asking myself questions. And what's good about Quizlet, another thing, is that you can be walking around campus, you can be laying in bed, and you don't have to have any lights on. You can just look through the index cards on your phone. So you
heat a lot.
Another helpful thing for EMT class is to go to your teacher and ask for previous questions that they used on previous tests, because a lot of times they do repeat. So doing a lot of practice questions will definitely help you prepare for the wording they're going to use on the test, and also you might even see some repeat questions that you already know the answer to. And if you can't find questions through your teacher, I'm pretty sure you can look online for previous EMT exams for the practice questions.
So a test-taking tip for the EMT exam is that when you get a situational question, like describing the patient that you have, the situation you're presented with, you can close your eyes and imagine the situation. Imagine that patient in front of you presenting with those symptoms, and it'll become a lot more clear on what you're supposed to do. So I've not taken the MCAT yet. I don't plan on taking that until my senior year, because I do plan on taking at least one gap year. But I do know how I'm going to study for that. But I plan on self-studying. I don't plan on taking one of the courses. And that's just personal preference. It's really all about how you learn best, what you think will work best for you. Right now, the plan is to start studying at the beginning of the summer, so probably the end of May, and study every single day from probably about from 9 to 5, and treating it like a job, so making sure that I don't miss a day, I show up, and I give it my all for that day. And I plan on going through each of my prerequisite courses, and I'll probably get some sort of study book to help me along in the process, going through my notes from those classes. And I want to leave enough time so I can do a ton of practice problems, you know, go through practice tests as if it's the actual exam day. And that's how I plan.
Okay, so we just got a question asking, was it scary first becoming an EMT?
Yes, it's still scary.
You never know what you're going to get, so yeah.
I think it's important to note that as an EMT, and especially us crew chief training right now, you're in charge of someone's healthcare, and that is a big responsibility, and you can't take that lightly. So yeah, it's still nerve-wracking, but it's so worth it, and I love it so much.
On top of it being a big responsibility, it's also scary because you never know what you're gonna walk into. You can get shootings, stabbings, drugs, like So, just for your own personal well-being, it's a little bit intimidating. Some agencies even carry bulletproof vests, which is scary in itself. And some of your patients will be violent with you. I've had patients, not personally with me, but hit my crew members, and I was there to see it, so it was definitely really scary, but overall, it's really worth it, like getting to save somebody's life and just make their day a little bit better by helping them.
And it's important to remember that this very well may be the worst day of your patient's life, and to be able to lessen that even a little bit is really amazing.
Our next question is if we work in a hospital or in an ambulance, and what kind of skills we perform as EMT. So we work on an ambulance, not in a hospital. And some of the skills we do basic life support, so basically we can do CPR. EMTs have 8 different drugs in their scope of practice, at least in New York State. And we have simple airway adjuncts called OPAs. We also learn how to do proper patient assessment skills, which is really valuable, especially going into the medical field, because all levels of healthcare providers use the same model to perform a patient assessment. So it's like the baseline of all medicine. So it's really good to learn before you apply, and it looks good. We can also do splinting. So if you break a leg or break your arm, we learn how to splint, and we learn bleeding control, shock management.
So both are great options. I would just personally choose EMT over CNA, just because I think that you're going to get a little bit more direct patient contact, which I think will lend itself to more meaningful experiences you can talk about on your interviews, and also just for your own sake. As an EMT, you take on more of an independent provider role rather than a supporting role, which both are extremely important, but I think that for the purpose of medical school or PA school, you're going to, like I said, get more meaningful experiences from being an EMT. I also feel like working in the pre-hospital setting will give you a unique perspective for when you do work in a hospital one day, because you'll know, you know, the other side of healthcare. Because as an EMS provider, you're the first person to see that patient, and you see the true condition of what they're in, and that gives you a leg up, and also gives you a greater appreciation.
If I don't get into PA school after trying a bunch of times, that's my plan, is to just keep trying over and over and over again until I hopefully get in eventually. But if I really can't get in and I'm getting too old and I really need to start getting a career, then I'm probably going to go to nursing school and practice for a few years as an RN, and then go to nurse practitioner school, because nurse practitioners and PAs are relatively.
So if I don't get into medical school the first time around, I'm definitely going to try again. I'll probably max out at like 3 tries and then I'll end up moving on. But I'm definitely going to keep on trying if I don't get in the first time. But eventually, when I feel it's time to move on, my plan B is to become a paramedic.
So we actually both have the same GPA. I have a 3.50 and Morgan has a 3.52. So basically the same thing.
Hello. A lot of you are asking why I chose PA and why Morgan chose doctor, so I'm going to get started with answering that question. It will probably take a little bit. There are a lot of reasons why I want to be a PA over a doctor. Just looking at both of the careers side by side and comparing them, I think that PA fits the lifestyle I want to live more closely. One of the advantages of PA school is that it's a 2-year program rather than 4, so you're not in as Another reason is the more flexible schedule that a PA has. They typically have more time to spend with family. And another advantage to being a PA is that it's very easy to switch specialties, which is not as easy for a doctor because they have fellowships. PAs can also prescribe medications, diagnose, and treat illnesses, so they still are able to do most of the things that doctors can do. PAs also tend to develop closer relationships with their patients because they spend much more time in the room and hands-on care with the patients than the doctors. If you're interested in learning more about the PA profession, I really recommend the book called So You Want to Be a PA. I'll post a picture of it in a second. it's really just a personal preference. No career choice is better than another. It's just about what you want to do for yourself.
So I know a lot of you guys have been asking why I chose physician over physician assistant, and I actually have four main reasons.
So my main reason for choosing the physician route is that they have complete autonomy and the broadest scope of practice.
Obviously, that's just personal preference, but for me, I don't want to have a supervising physician or anything like that. I just want to automatically have autonomy. And my second reason kind of goes hand in hand with autonomy, where as a physician, I can take on a leadership role. That's something that's very important to me. So much of healthcare today is collaborating with other healthcare professionals and working as a team to provide patient care. And as a physician, I would be able to be the head of that team. And I really enjoy taking on a leadership role, and I tend to thrive in situations where people look to me in a time of crisis. And that's part of the reason why I really love crew chief training right now as an EMT. I also really want to go into academic medicine, and becoming a physician will allow me to have that sort of lifestyle. So what I mean by academic medicine is that I will be an attending physician, seeing my own patients, and then I'll also have residents that I'm teaching, and I will also be conducting research. And my last main point is that as a physician, I will be a specialist in whatever field I decide to go into. I like the idea of becoming an expert on a particular specialty and knowing everything that there is to know on it or that you could possibly know about it. Overall, the decision is all about personal preference. The physician track is more in line with what I want out of a career, but there's
my favorite BLS skill would definitely have to be using the BVM, which is the little balloon thingy that you see them squeeze on TV to help a person breathe. I've used this on two patients. One patient was actually awake and still alive. The other patient was unconscious. So the reason why you would want to use a BVM on somebody who's still alive is if they're not breathing enough to sustain life. So for example, the guy that I did this on was only breathing. For the guy who was alive, I was sitting over him and actually looking into his eyes the entire time, which is something I'll never forget because I was actually looking into his eyes as I was saving his life, which was something that was extremely rewarding for me, and I'll definitely never forget that. So yeah, BVM is my favorite. No, EMTs don't have their own malpractice insurance, but there's a doctor that heads the EMS agency that you work for, and they're called the medical director. So, depending on the agency you worked for, you would be practicing under the medical director's license. So, it's their physician license that you're practicing on. However, this doesn't stop people from filing civil lawsuits against you. EMTs have been brought to court before for things that they've either messed up on or failed to do. So, you have to be really careful, and you have to make sure that you stay up to date on your state protocols, and you have to document everything that you do on the.
If that is what you want to do and that's what you're passionate about, then absolutely go for it. However, you want to keep in mind that it is a really intense either 1 or 2 year program, and that might be a little too much to handle while you have your hard courses that you're taking in your undergrad. And you also need a lot of clinical hours in paramedic. I don't mean to discourage you, because it has certainly been done before. It's just really difficult, and you might be adding some unnecessary stress onto your already stressful course load. There is a slightly less involved alternative to becoming a paramedic, and that's becoming an EMT intermediate in pretty much every state other than New York, and New York is called a critical care. For the EMTCC in particular, me and Deanna are actually going to do that in our senior year, so in 2 years we're going to complete that. It's about half the amount of clinical hours that you would do for the paramedic, but it actually has a really similar scope of practice as a paramedic. And the reason why we are waiting 2 years to complete the CC course is that we want to have a really strong foundation in BLS care before we move on to ALS care. So the intermediate and CCs are great options if you want a similar scope of practice to a paramedic, but don't want that time commitment of the program. So the next question is if we took AP classes in high school, and the answer is yes. I took 7 and Deanna took 6.
So we're both in psychology statistics right now at our school, which is a requirement for our integrative neuroscience major. That's why we had to take it again.
Different PA schools have different prerequisite requirements, so I recommend going onto the PA school's website and looking at the prerequisite courses that are needed. So most PA schools don't require calculus or anything like that that I know certain med schools do require, but again, it's a PA school to PA school basis. So you're definitely going to want to look up the exact courses to make sure that you're on the right track. Another way to make sure that you're on the right track to get into PA school is to go to the PA school and talk to an administrator. And I actually did that for Toro College. I brought my transcript and we just went over it, and basically she told me I am so far on the right track towards getting into PA school, which was really helpful. So I'd recommend looking into some PA schools in your area or PA schools that you're interested in attending, calling them up and trying to set up an appointment to meet with them. I'd like to share with you guys a study method that I used last semester for one of my classes where my professor relied mostly on. So all the material that was on the test came from lecture, which made it kind of difficult because you had to literally write down everything that he said. So what I started doing was I would use a voice recorder and record his lectures, and while I was in lecture I would write down everything that I could. And then after class, I would go back with a different colored marker and I would listen to the lecture with my headphones and take notes on whatever I missed. So it was really helpful because it was essentially like I was listening to the lectures twice, and also I was able to write down all the information. I ended up getting an A- in the class, so I ended up doing well and doing well on the tests. It definitely helped me study, so I really recommend it for classes like that.
So I'm interested in either allopathic medicine or osteopathic medicine, and that's just because kind of like how I chose doctor over PA just aligns with what I it just aligns better with what I want out of a career. And for those of you who don't know, osteopathic physicians are DOs and allopathic physicians are MDs. So earlier on SNAP, I talked about how I'm a part of a mentorship program at my school where we partnered up with our sister school, which is SUNY Upstate Medical School. And undergraduate students get matched up with medical students there, and the med student kind of becomes their go-to person that they can ask questions and anything like that when they need it. This program was actually started by a medical student at SUNY Upstate, and he just coordinated it with our pre-health office. So I'm sure that if you wanted to start a program like this at your school, I would just reach out to a nearby medical school. Maybe even just talking to their Department of Admissions to start off with and seeing where to go. And the admissions office can probably point you in the right direction on where to go from there. Or if you happen to know a medical student, maybe reach out to them and try and organize it. You could also probably talk to the head of your pre-health advising office about, you know, what channels to go through to get it all figured out and set up. And that. So there are any physical requirements in the sense that you have to go through a physical test in order to take the class or to become an EMT. However, it is a very physical job, so you need to be able to lift patients who might be a lot bigger than you. You need to be able to lift the stretcher, push the stretcher. There are different types of stretchers.
Yes, any sort of patient contact can count as patient contact hours. It doesn't necessarily have to be that, you know, you're saving someone's life. It's still patient contact. If you have questions as to what's going to count towards your patient care hours, I would recommend calling up the PA school or the medical school and just confirming before you put time. So GPA is far from the only thing that PA schools and medical schools are going to look at. They also put a lot of emphasis on your patient care hours and your volunteer. So I really recommend trying to have a really diverse resume. Try to put a lot of different volunteer and patient care experience, and it will make up for your lower GPA.
You can also make up for a lower GPA by doing a post-bac program or by completing a master's degree to help replace some of those lower grades. So a post-bac program is essentially just redoing all of your prerequisites that you completed the first time around but maybe didn't do as well as you wanted to on.
So we're both integrative neuroscience majors, and the best way I like to describe a neuroscience major is a combination of psychology and biology.
Integrative neuroscience is also a really convenient major for pre-health students because it includes a lot of the prerequisites that you're going to need for medical school and PA school. So we're only on here for another hour, so send all of your questions in. So in an earlier video, I mentioned that I'm taking a gap year, maybe more than one. And basically the reason for that is I feel like I won't be ready. And what I mean by not ready is that medical school is such a huge undertaking. It is such a long stretch and a long period of my life. And at 21 years old, I just don't think that I'll be ready for that. And I also want to live a little before I do, and I don't think that anything's wrong with that. But people take gap years for all sorts of reasons. That's just my own personal reason. So it's really up to you and what you want to do. Some people go straight through. Like I mentioned earlier, I do plan on taking the AEMTCC class in my senior year, and I plan on working as a critical care tech during my gap. Also during my gap years, while I'm working, I also want to save up money and travel because I won't have the opportunity to travel during college, and I really want to do that before I enter medical school. Also, another reason that I'm taking a gap year is that I really, really love working in EMS, and I definitely want to continue with pre-hospital care before I enter. I'm so passionate about emergency medicine, and I feel like it's a really great stepping stone from just being a student and really a kid into being a medical student and future doctor, which is such a big undertaking, such a huge responsibility.
I actually came into my freshman year of college thinking I wanted to be a biology major. I had never heard of an integrative neuroscience major, but then once I got here, I heard of... So from joining the prePA club and things like that, I heard of a bunch of people talking about the integrative neuroscience major, and I wanted to find out more about it. And it really interested me a lot because I love psychology and I love biology, so it's a combination of my two favorite things to learn about. So it's really interesting for me, and it's easy to study. It's easy to study for because I find it much easier to study for something that you're interested in rather than something that you don't care about. So I like it, so it's easy to study for. As for a minor, I'm considering doing a biological anthropology minor. I'm in an intro level biological anthropology class right now, and I really like it. It's really interesting. But I haven't really made up my mind yet. You don't need to have a minor to apply to PA school or med school. Again, it'll just diversify your resume a little bit more. I haven't decided yet. As far as picking a major goes, you don't actually have to do a major in a science or in something health related. You can be an English major, whatever you want. So I recommend majoring in something that you're really interested in, and all you would have to do is just make sure you take the appropriate prerequisite courses that you need. Majoring in something not health related might make it a little bit harder, but if you're really interested in, let's say, history or English, and you want to learn about both that and medicine, then go for it.
I actually started college at a different school, and there I was a psychobiology major with a minor in disaster studies. I'm currently an integrative neuroscience major, but I'm actually thinking about changing it again. So I'm really interested in public health, emergency management, disaster studies, things like that, and we have a program here at Binghamton where you can pretty much make your own major. So I'm actually meeting with my advisor soon to talk about making my own major, incorporating my prerequisites for medical school, some biological anthropology classes, some public health classes, some disaster studies classes, public policy, just kind of making my own major based on my interests, which is really cool. If I don't make my own major, I'll probably minor in biological anthropology just because that's what my research is in, so I already know I really like it and I have some classes already.
So Morgan and I actually have known each other since kindergarten. We were 5 years old when we met, and we're best friends. And so Morgan and I started to get really close actually when we went away to college. She went to New Paltz and I went to Binghamton right out of high school. And so I would always text Morgan in the middle of the night, like 3 a.m., asking for advice about my current boyfriend. And so she was always there for me, and that. And then our second semester of our freshman year, she transferred here, and we've just been really close ever since. So an aide on an ambulance is basically someone who's there to just help out the crew. Basically, you can take vitals, you can set up IVs. An EMT is a medically licensed technician who can provide basic life support to patients. So it's not like your full... So it's not a full ALS provider, but they can do basic life skills like we outlined before, some of the things that we can do. A paramedic is also a medically licensed technician, but they go to school for 2 years and they're often referred to as pre-hospital doctors. Paramedics can intubate, they can start IVs, they can give pain medicine, they can give all different sorts of medicines intravenously. So the main difference between EMTs and paramedics is basically scope of practice. So paramedics have a wider scope of practice than EMTs, but they train. So for PA school, you need to go to 4 years of undergrad, and then you do a 2-year master program. So overall, 6 years of school to become a PA. I don't think anybody's gone to college and hasn't received a bad grade in anything. It sucks, and it's a dig at the self-confidence, but the most important thing about getting a bad grade is to not let it define the rest of your semester or the rest of your school career. You have to just brush it off and do well in other things. There are going to be classes that you don't typically like, you really don't take well to, you don't take well to the professor, and that's fine. You might not do well in every class, but that's extremely normal, and it's important to keep that in mind, especially when you're getting really down on yourself. You just got to get up, brush it off, and do better on the next test or in the next class. So I definitely think it's a really great idea to take AP Physics and AP Calc in high school, just because they tend to be extremely hard in college and easier in high school. I think it's a really great idea to get some of those really tough courses out of the way before college so that it's easier for you in college to do well. So from the time when I was a really little girl, I always knew I wanted to go into medicine, and for years I always thought I wanted to be a nurse. But then my senior year of high school, I came across the PA profession. I read a book about it and decided it was definitely the right choice for me, and it was what I wanted to do with my life.
So I've pretty much known since I came out the womb, which is like a big joke. My parents joke around that my first word was doctor. It's always been something that I wanted to do, and it's always been that intrinsic desire to help others. And as I got older, I looked into it more and really kind of got into the nitty-gritty of becoming a doctor, you know, how long it takes, the steps it takes to get there, the tests you need to take at each step. And at this point, I'm pretty sure I've watched just about every single video and read every single blog written by any med student or resident or doctor on the internet. I've heard all the horror stories, I know exactly what I'm getting myself into, and I still want to do it. In fact, learning about the journey made me want to do it more, because it made me respect it and appreciate. So I've always known that I wanted to be a doctor, but when I learned the technicalities of how to get there, I loved it even more. So I plan on studying for an entire summer, so 3 or 4 months straight, Monday through Friday, treating it like a job, 9 to 5.
Thank you guys so much for tuning in today. Thanks for all the great questions. If you have any more questions that we didn't get to answer, feel free to email us in the link below.
And also be sure to follow our Instagram. We answer a lot of questions on there, and we post a few times a week. Thank you all. Also, we just wanted to thank Andrea for letting us come on Med Takeovers. We had so much fun. And also keep an eye out for our blog post coming on medtakeovers.com.